folks. We're doing a deep dive analysis of the top four residential REITs in Canada, including one that is recently IPO'd that is offering over an 8% dividend yield. It has become quite apparent since this pandemic has taken place that most people are operating out of their homes. And with this recent explosion, this throppiness, and almost seeming like a bubble in the residential real estate market across North America, not even localized to Canada, I always find myself turning to REITs because they already have a foundational, stable portfolio that I can just buy into rather than having to chase residential, real physical property myself. So in the clarity of my transparency and all the wonderful homework I'm presenting here for you, consider hitting that like button, folks, and let's kick this off by talking about Canada's number one largest apartment and just general residential REIT, being Canadian Apartment Properties REIT. It trades for $55 a share, sits at about a $9.4 billion market cap, and has been existing for more than 20 years. Unlike most REITs, this is at a stable capital gain incline, and it is up about 398% since the IPO here. Now, you're only getting a 2.5% starting yield, which I know is not that attractive, but this company does increase the yield, which we'll see when we actually get into the dividend payout here, folks. But just taking a look at the diversification list, you're getting very well diversified across all of Canada, and even some global diversification going into the Netherlands. We can see we've got British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Ontario, Quebec, New Brunswick, the whole nine yards here, with $578 million in net operating income here, folks. And just breaking down the quarterly, for 2021, they actually increased the bottom line by 5.3%, which is pretty impressive for operating revenue, going from the first quarter of 2020 at $216 million to $227 million for 2021, with the payout ratio, which matters a lot. We're going to bring this up a few times throughout this video, because this is, can they actually afford to stabilize and continue paying out the dividend? And yes, their payout ratio has actually decreased to 62.3% of Q1 of 2021. Now, just further expanding, taking a look at their assets minus their liabilities, $15.5 billion in assets against $6.2 billion in liabilities. This company has a real foundational base here of just, what, about $8 billion in underlying assets. So you are paying a bit of a premium against the underlying market cap of, what do we say, around $10 billion here, or $9.4 billion. So yeah, you're paying a little bit over the premium for the underlying asset. But nonetheless, guys, let's just take a look at that performance again, because I mean, just take a look at the steady growth from 2017, from $638 million in revenue, to 2020 at $882 million. This company has had no problem having management actually expand the operations very successfully. Now, where I get a little confused is on the dividend payout here, because going into Y charts, we can see the last time they increased the dividend was on the first quarter of 2019, and they haven't increased it since, even though for the last several years, they've increased it year over year. So clearly the pandemic has made them take a step back, try and mitigate some of the risks, but with such a low payout ratio, I'd have to do more due diligence to figure out why they haven't raised it, but maybe something to look forward to in the coming future here. But nonetheless, that is Canada's number one largest residential REIT. Leading us into numero dos, the second largest residential REIT, being Interrent, a real estate investment trust, trading for $15.41 a share, founded in 2006, so not as long of a history as Carr, but nonetheless, guys, trading up 450% since the IPO, a starting yield a lot less at 2.11%, a little bit lower of a PE, and a much smaller market cap of $2.1 billion. Let's get right into this here, folks. Taking a look at their diversification list, it is much more knit, obviously being a smaller REIT. We can see their diversification comes from British Columbia, Ontario, Quebec, and of course, we got some Montreal and the GTA. They kind of hone in on the provinces where they're more localized. And just taking a look, they have 113 properties with a total of 11,977 units or suites. And just diving down into what their plan is here, they're basically just buying residential units like any other valued real estate investor, you know, looking for those value deals where you find fixer-uppers. And we can see that's exactly what they do. They just find what would probably be value adds to REITs that are trading at fair value or undervalue or residential properties here, guys. And just taking an expanded view, we can see that they've really cleaned them up. They have pools, they make them look great, places people would obviously want to live. And again, getting into the assets, minusing the liabilities, minusing the $3.2 billion in assets, minus $1.1 billion in liability, which leaves them with a whopping $2.1 billion in underlying assets, trading excessively close to their market capitalization. You are paying exact fair valuation for the underlying asset this company currently holds. And even just taking a look at the revenue, guys, it isn't as fast growing as Carr, but it's still very steady, going from $145 million in 2019 into 2020. still increasing to $160 million. So both of these companies are really robust. The dividend yield is not great. We're getting some capital growth, but my God, these companies have survived this pandemic with ease, in my personal and humble opinion. And taking a look at the payout ratio, a much higher than CAR by about 10%, the Canadian Apartment REIT, it's paying out a ratio of about 76% with some room to still grow up. But unlike Canadian Apartment REIT, this one has actually increased the dividend even going through the pandemic here. So they have continued to increase it year over year. And again, we're not talking about hugely massive increases. I mean, they were paying out what, 0.019 cents going into 2017, at which they're at 0.027 cents. So a healthy increase over time, making that lower yield seem much more attractive for long-term investors that are looking for more stability with a little bit of a growth on top of that, right? Now, taking a look at number three, my favorite REIT we are going to be looking at right now amongst the last two when we're talking about scale and stability, and that is Killam Apartment REIT, trading for $18.96. Only recently IPO'd, but has been founded since 2000, but the chart here only seems to go back to about 2016. And taking a look, guys, their dividend much higher than both of those at 3.58%, a little higher of a PE ratio with almost a dead even $2 billion market cap. And taking a look at this company's properties, again, a little bit more less diversified across the entire province, but still, nonetheless, the entire apartment unit set at 17,377, with a lot of them being in Alberta. We've got some in Ontario, a little bit in New Brunswick here as well, PEI. So somewhat relatively diversified across the Canadian sector, not globally, so a little more knit, obviously. But this company, the reason I like it so much is they are doing a mass amount of upgrades right now. And this is the first REIT that I've seen so far that is leaning into renewable energy. They are trying to reduce the cost of their energy consumption by installing solar into many of their properties here, guys. And they're doing much more upgrades and just basically what we would call value adds, just like some of the other REITs we were looking at here, folks. So continuing to take a look at their properties, though, my goodness, the development this company has going on is kind of juicy, in my opinion, because they're doing a massive expansion in Ottawa with 228 units for the Ottawa one, 101 units for Fredericton, Cambridge. I know all of these areas. It isn't highly as focused as some of the REITs that I already own, but still incredibly well-diversified REIT here, guys. And how much are we paying for this? Well, if we minus the $3.7 billion they have in assets against the $2 billion they have in liabilities, they're sitting on about $1.7 billion in underlying assets. So we are paying, again, a relative premium to the underlying asset at $1.9 billion. But for what we're getting here, the stability, the higher yield, I don't think too many are complaining. And speaking of that higher yield, let's just first take a look at the growth. Because again, these companies, guys, are some of the few REITs that have been growing through the pandemic, which is why you should be paying attention to these, even though they're yielding lower dividends. But still, nonetheless, guys, first the payout ratio. This one sits at 82%, so higher yield, much higher payout ratio that has actually been declining since 2016. Somehow they've done a good job at not only increasing the dividend, but getting the payout ratio to go down over time, giving us a little bit more comfortability in the bleed room and the management that is running this. But let's just get right down into the Y charts, because this one as well looks like it is expected to do another dividend increase this year if they plan on doing annual increases. Because going back to 2017, from 0.05 cents to today, we're at 0.057. We're not talking about massively quick increasing dividend yields here, guys, but that comes with the joys of it, a higher starting percentage yield, right? So I would be relatively expecting this company to increase the dividend any time, I would hope, this year. But because this company deals with really awesome apartments in great locations, they're really developing into the natural renewable energy. The fact that they've had increased growth through the pandemic, higher yield starting, there's no reason to hate this one, guys. This might be the top of the list of the three apartment REITs we just looked at. So those are the largest, most stable residential REITs you can currently buy in Canada. But I have found a new one in the small cap sector that recently IPO'd, and you can find really exuberated high yields in the small cap sector. I just try and avoid it because usually there's a lot less stability. The companies haven't been around for as long. There's no proven track record. But if you have a little bit more tolerated risk tolerance and you maybe want to add a diversified portfolio of these and you want to get the yield a little higher, let me recommend Northview Canadian High Yield Residential Fund. Now, keep in mind, these are just the residential sector. There's a whole other suite of sectors with logistics, You can get into like RioCan with the malls and a lot more commercially based. But these guys are mostly 100% residential with a little bit of commercial mix. But taking a look, I had to do a lot more due diligence with this one because unfortunately, Yahoo Finance hasn't even updated the data on it yet because it is so new. It only recently IPO'd as of November of 2020, and it has been on the up and up, trading up 19.63% since. And getting into my overview on my iTrade account, because I cannot see it again on Google or Yahoo, I had to do a lot more digging. We can see that the market cap sits at 106 million, which I do not believe is actually accurate. Again, this information is skewed. However, the dividend yield, I do believe, starts at 8.4%, which is astronomically much higher. Now, this REIT, way more diversified for how small of a cap it is, but it's focusing on really interesting residential that I'm still doing more due diligence on. But taking a look, multi-residential makes up the vast majority of it. And like I said, they have about 18% commercial. And just going through it, Northwest Territories, British Columbia, lots and lots of units here, guys, considering they have 1,300 units in the Northwest Territories with 532,000 square feet of commercial. British Columbia, 1,300 units. Alberta, what is that? Total multi-residential, 3,500 units. Going through all of this, guys, very well diversified across the provinces. And just taking a look at the actual on properties themselves, these are really interesting units that they're claiming are in areas where there is no longer expansion allowed. So they're saying that there will be little to no competition or any more building going on because they might be experiencing what we have in Ontario called the Green Belt. The government regulates and mandates land. Like, you can only sever off so much land and have so much commercial and development land. Nonetheless, on the commercial side of the portfolio, guys, I have to applaud them. They've done very well here considering that their primary tenants are UPS, Loblaws, Ferguson and Walmart, and they even have government tenants in their buildings, which even better, right? Apparently, approximately 66% of the rental revenue from Nunavut and the Northwest Territories is derived from leases to or leases guaranteed by government or credit rated operations. So, I mean, at least a good little chunk of their portfolio is to do the exact numbers, you might have to run some math here, because if we know that it's 66% going back up to these properties, we can see that's a lot of units, guys. 1,300 units in Northwest. And what did they say about Nunavut over here? That's another 1,100 units. A lot of commercials. So at least you'd have to run some percentage basis to see exactly how much of the portfolio is that foundationally stable. Maybe something that I'll do in an upcoming video if you guys want a more deeper analysis on this stock. But getting right into their books in and of itself, taking a look at the total assets, they sit on about $1.86 billion, which is why I had a hard time understanding the market cap in my Scotia iTrade account. Doesn't make a whole lot of sense considering their total liabilities sit right at around $1.1 billion. So their current liabilities, so that gives them about a $600 million underlying asset value, which again gives me some confusion when Google only says they're worth $106 million. So a little bit of a off communication between data here, but again, brand new REIT financially. But just taking a look, guys, at the actual numbers, the payout ratio, where things get a lot more convoluted. Some of these other REITs, what they like to do in the pandemic when things arise, when they have issues in certain properties, they do what we call write-downs or amortization losses. And we can see that their net operating income, guys, for the three-month end of March 31st, 2021, they brought in about $26 million, okay? What I like to do is, again, find that payout ratio, which if we can find here, they actually do include it for the distribution to unit holders, was about $11.2 million. So that's not really a huge amount of that net operating income, right? But we can see, we scroll down, they have a net comprehensive loss of about $1.2 million. So how are they losing money? That kind of scares me as a shareholder. Can they afford this dividend? Are they going to cut it? Well, just taking a look, guys, we can see, again, the fair value loss on investment properties, they wrote down about $3.5 million. And then when we take a look at the depreciation and amortization costs, which sit at about, if I'm lining that up correctly, about $830,000, combine that with the fair value loss, I mean, you're looking at over $4 million. So they have plenty of leeway if they didn't include these write-downs to pay their dividend and continue to basically manage the properties that they own. So the payout ratio, I'm a little confusing here, but lots of leeway. I would think that it's around 80%, maybe a little higher than that. So with these kind of smaller cap REITs that pay much higher yields, the payout ratio is usually a lot higher. But what a fascinating REIT. I chose this one because a buddy of mine in my chat group mentioned about it, and I've never heard of it before. And comparing it to some other small cap REITs, I would have to say that this one is much better poised. So in light of all of this, folks, these are the top four Canadian residential dividend REITs that I think are worth taking a look at, especially in this market. The fact that you don't have to chase actual physical real estate when you can get incredible yields and growth from nothing better than what's already been established. So in light of all of this, I pass the question off to you. What do you think in that comment section below? Stay cool, stay awesome, and I look forward to catching you tomorrow.